leads to legalistic life, that kind of, you know, thou shalt not be found out kind of morality, and of which is actually quite prevalent in evangelical circles. So long as nobody knows, then it's almost like a form of righteousness. It's not about whether other people know or not. It's about the God who sees all things, being pleased or not pleased. That's what we're concerned about. So truth without love leads to much hiding. You know, people who hurt within and self-medicate with alcohol and drugs and stuff like that, it's because of this kind of legalistic type of truth, where they're hurting about something and they're afraid, including our children, they're afraid to speak about these doubts that they're having, these struggles that they're having, because who's going to listen to me anyway? And even if I share, who's going to understand what I'm talking about? And so they decide to solve the problems themselves. And this is what I'm finding among not only children, but also older people. They can't share because they're not sure that anyone will hear them, truly hear them. Because in Christian circles, as soon as I open my mouth and I say something that doesn't quite fit the Christian culture, there's judgment. Before the person has even heard all the details, there's judgment. So people end up hurting within. You know, truth without love produces that. And that is the same of our children. Truth without love produces hypocrisy, withdrawal, actors. So one of the things that happens with some of our children, they're so good at keeping the rules when they're with us. And then they go off to Unza. I'm talking about real people here. I'm talking about real people that I'm dealing with. And maybe to be more specific, I've got a young lady in my head. She leaves my church, she goes to Unza, and she has a reputation when she's at home about her holiness, about her seriousness in Christian things, about the fact that she was a virgin, and all the rest of it. The next thing, she's having an abortion, and another abortion, and an ectopic in a pregnancy. Fortunately, you have no idea what I'm talking about, so I can say some of these things. And struggling, who is she going to talk about? So the only time that the parents get wind of it is when she has an ectopic pregnancy and she has to go for surgery. Before that, who is she going to talk about? But then the question that I ask, but why does she feel that she's going to find love in the arms of some non-Christian who's really got his own agenda? And sometimes it's because they've not known love in that unconditional way. And so some non-Christian guy says, I love you. It's like water to a thirsty soul. And I'm willing to give anything for this person who says they love me. So that's one of the reasons I tell Christian parents, especially your girl children, tell them you love them. Let them hear it from you.
But they pay the fees. So you say a lot of
that. It's not like in some machine, 2 plus 2 equals 4. Let them hear it. It's important for them to hear it. You read your Bible and you find out how many times God tells us he loves us. Read your Bible, find out how many times our Father says we're precious to him. That we're like the apple of his eye. That you do this and you do that for us because he loves us. And when he sends his son into the world, this is because I love the world so much. That's why I'm sending my son. into the world. When he sends his apostle into the world, the apostle says, I'm constrained by the love of Christ. I see everything from that perspective. We have girls getting themselves into these problems. It's very little to do with morality. It's got everything to do with simple needs to be loved. Just to feel that they're precious to somebody. And of course they get it wrong. Like this, you know, very girl, Grandpa, I don't know who else to talk to. So she sends a message to me, just to talk to someone who will hear me, who will not judge me. You know, that guy that I gave myself to is now gone off with some other girl. It doesn't surprise me. Because you're trying to solve the problem the wrong way. We need to equip people to be able to make those healthy decisions, but in the context of grace, in the context of love. So we can produce hypocrisy and actors who perform very well until they are in a place where there is little accountability. And I think I hinted at this in the first in our first session, that sometimes loud people can hide behind their loudness. They say a lot, but you know nothing about it, because they don't really share their heart. They don't really share what's hurting. They don't really share what they're thinking. They're just sharing whatever will hide more important things. And then, of course, the withdrawn people who don't say anything, you don't know anything about them. But our God is a God who wants to share the truth with us in a way that engages us. He says to us, come, let's reason together. Does this make sense? Does that make sense? How have I let you down? How is it that you're leaving the living waters and you're, you know, digging cisterns that will not hold water? That doesn't make sense. Let's reason together. Let's be sensible. He doesn't just say, I say so. I mean, okay, sometimes it does. You know, I am the Lord. I am the Lord. I am the Lord. You know, I know better, which is true. I mean, he's the only one who can say that. But even though he's the one who knows all things, nevertheless, he respects us enough to call us into dialogue. Even when we've messed up, Adam, where are you? I'm hiding because I was afraid. Okay, let's talk about it. What has happened exactly? Just to help me along, that I'm not shockable. Is it possible that you ate the fruit that I told you not to eat from? And then you know the rest of the story. But God is engaging Abraham, Adam rather. And it's not that God is ignorant. God, you don't play hide and seek with God. I mean, he knows where you're hiding. But he asks the question because of the dignity that he has bestowed upon us. It's because of his respect for us. So he doesn't barge into your room without knocking. You remember? Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. God is a gentleman. And it's not like, you know, some of us parents, because we are parents, we can walk into our kid's room and somehow it's our right to do that. It's disrespectful. If a letter was written to my kids when they are primary school, I would never open a letter that's not addressed to me. I would not go in my boys' room without knocking. Much less go in my daughter's bedroom without knocking. Respecting their space is a way of showing respect for them. They're important. What they think is important, what they feel is important, their boundaries are important, and God treats us that way. This is the way we walk in it. It doesn't go dragging us. He shows us the way that we might walk in. Our God is very reasonable. Let me make a few a few more specific comments about applying the truth then to our children. Here are a few things to keep in mind. Number one, our children are individuals. We've already alluded to this. So this business of you have six children, I love them all the same. It's not helpful. Children are individuals. I had to learn this fairly early, partly because I was programmed in a certain way because of my own upbringing. My father had certain expectations of me when I was at school. If I did not come number one, I might as well have failed. That was the message that my father communicated with me. Because he compared me to himself, that he always came number one. So if you didn't come number one, you might as well have failed. But at the same time, there was no actual encouragement or any sense of achievement. So to me, if I came number one, it was no big deal. It was almost like that was just normal. That's the thing you did. I think the only time that father seemed to be a little bit excited, even a chicken died, was when I was not just number one in my school, but I was number one in the district, and I think I came number two in the whole of the Northern Province, and you know, we're not even competing to go to the same school. And then we ended up at Muyombe because, you know, there was a mental arithmetic exam whose rules I did not understand. This times that times that times zero times that times that. And I'm busy trying to work that out. So I lost one mark and came one mark behind some guy from Kasama. Anyway, so my father was quite excited about that. So I really learned very little about education. I only discovered how to do exams when I'm doing my second degree. And towards the end of my second degree, that's when I was learning things about, you know, how to handle exams. So it's just really like some sponge. I mean, I'll sit there and absorb stuff and reproduce stuff. I mean, that's not how you get educated. So when I had my own children, I had similar expectations from them that my father had of me. And then discovered my children are not necessarily, you know, wired in the same way. So when my child gets 80% thinking, what? What happened to that 20%? How on earth do you come home with 80%? What's up with that? Especially in primary school. I mean, if there are 100% worth of questions, then you come home with 100%. This business of 80%, my gosh, I just, you are too well. So I soon realized that it doesn't work that way. That how my first son is wired is very different from how my second son is wired. They're not going to score the same and stop expecting what their grandfather was expecting of me. Then different individuals. I think I shared with you, you know, one of them used to visit the study and got a little bit more of this. You know, I never quit going. Partly because he was an actor. He knew how to keep the rules. He knew how to get out of trouble. And so he gave the impression to all of us that he was such a wonderful, or, you know, come and just let it all hang out. And he paid the price. So we don't treat children the same. So be careful with the one size fits all approach. That's not how God deals with us. So when God is giving Peter an assignment, you love me? Yes, Lord, I do. Then feed my sheep. What about John? That's none of your business. The business that I have with John has got nothing to do with you. You feed my sheep. That is the assignment that I have for you. So doing someone else's good work can be sin. Because you're leaving your good work undone. Because you're trying to imitate someone else. So our children are individuals. That's the principle that I want to share with you. Secondly, because that is so, be careful how you compare your children. One of the most hurtful things about some of our children is the way in which they've been negatively compared to other children. One of the most devastating things I've found with regard to women's self-image is because when they were born, their parents were expecting a boy. The trouble is, instead of keeping to themselves, they communicated the fact that they were rather disappointed. You know, when we're expecting a child, we were hoping for a boy, and then you came. How is a poor girl supposed to feel? So she either feels that she's such a big disappointment to the parents because she's a girl, or she lives her life trying to be like a boy, trying to compensate for the disappointment of the parents. Jesus came so that we might have life and live it in all its fullness. As us, not as someone else. And so some people are living someone else's life instead of living their life because of the silly things that we have said as parents, because of the unkind comparisons that we have made. So careful how you compare children with what? How can you be more like your brother? Why can't you be more like your sister? You know, she does this, she does that. And what that does, it just puts such pressure on this poor girl. Either trying to be like the sister, or says, you're going to see me or not my sister. And so she even maybe goes out of her way to prove that she is an individual. She's not going to conform to some artificial image. Maybe she even hates her sister because of the thing that you said. She resents this sister who is the kind of sunshine favorite kid. And you might not mean to do that. So be careful how you make comparisons. If you're going to make comparisons, be very careful that they are designed to encourage, but not to criticize, not to put anyone down. I mean, maybe a comparison like, you know, your sister is so small, but she tries, and she succeeded. So maybe if you also try a little bit bigger than her, you could. I mean, something like that, but not for criticizing, much less for putting anyone down. So let's be careful with that. Now watch the frustrations we were warned against, and especially as fathers. I don't know why that warning is in Ephesians 6 is directed to fathers. Fathers, don't exasperate your children. So let's be careful about that. And let's also, here is the fourth principle, I suppose, age-appropriate treatment of our children. So let's not treat the teenager as if they're toddlers. Let's not wait until they say to us, please, Dad, stop treating me as if I'm 8. I'm not 8 anymore, I'm not a child. Let's not wait to be told that. I mean, we can see that he's not 8 anymore. The guy is 16, so let's make a difference. Let's not wait until the protest comes along. Let's age-appropriate treatment of our children. And like I said earlier, respect the boundaries. So that we know, when do you carry a child? When do you simply guide and let them walk, they walk themselves? So we need to be patient. And this involves sometimes something that, and I sometimes remember this with a little bit of embarrassment, a little bit of amusement. Like at the months, this is one of the things I would say to my children. I would like to repeat myself. I said it once, and that's